Hello and welcome to the Geodic 2021 Visualization Workshop. My name is Rolf Westerteiger, I'm a senior software developer at Mathemarket, and in this workshop I will show you how to use the visualization features in Geodic 2021 to create impressive images and animations of your 3D image data, your microstructures and your simulation results. But first I would like to clarify why we consider visualization so important that we dedicate a whole workshop to this topic. Our brain processes visual information faster than it does text or numbers. We don't have to learn how to see pictures, but we do have to learn how to read. And even if the image does not communicate the core information, it can at least attract attention and make the interested person search the content for the desired information. A good visualization, no matter what kind, should make it easy for the viewer to acquire the desired information quickly and effortlessly. The viewer's expectation of the validity of the image in relation to the content of the information plays an important role in this respect as well. On the other hand, there is the desire to show pictures that are as elegant as possible. Here it is important to find the right balance. The results of this workshop will not be a fixed setting that can simply be applied to all cases. Every microstructure and every result field is different and has to be considered for itself. Rather, we will create a set of basic rules and a solid understanding of Geodic's visualization features in order to enable you to present your microstructures and results effectively in the future. This workshop is divided into three parts. In part one, we will look at how we can visualize 3D image data and the associated segmented and voxelized microstructures in an informative and appealing way. We will make sure that we will find a good compromise between descriptiveness and an attractive visualization. We will then save our results as image files. In part two, we will use the knowledge gained in part one to visualize a result field from a simulation. In addition, we will get to know further visualization options for such result fields. We will then save our resulting images using the built-in Geodic Easy Image app. In part three, we will look at the possibilities of video generation in Geodic. We will see how to create videos using the result viewer and GDR files and how to apply and adjust the templates in the video dialog. Now, without further ado, let's dive right into part one. Please start Geodic 2021. You should have received the workshop materials folder, and the first thing we want to do is change Geodic's project folder to this folder. So please click File, choose Project Folder, and select Project Folder. Then navigate to the place where you have stored the workshop materials and double-click into the Visualization Workshop Project Folder. This folder contains both the raw image data that we're going to use as inputs for the visualization, as well as all the outputs, images, and videos that we're going to generate during this workshop. So please click Select Folder. Now, the first thing I would like you to do is import a so-called GRW file. A GRW file is a Geodic RAW file which can contain 8, 16 or 32-bit gray value image data. In order to load this example file, please click File, Load Volume Field. Navigate to the Part 1 subfolder of your project folder. And then double-click the file called artificial3dimagedata.grw. In the upcoming dialog, please click OK. And now what we see here is a basic 2D visualization of the dataset with a default color scale on the right-hand side. To make things more interesting, let's switch to 3D mode immediately by clicking the 3D icon up here in the toolbar. And now we can see the same dataset in 3D. The basic navigation controls are using the mouse, and it works like this. If you use the left mouse button, click it and hold it, and move the mouse, you will rotate the data cube. If you click and hold the middle mouse button and move the mouse, you will translate the view. And likewise, clicking and holding the right mouse button and moving the mouse up and down will zoom the view. Now we will enter a somewhat isometric perspective here, where we can see at least three of the six faces of the cube, and then we will begin adjusting the visualization options like the color scale and transparency. Now, in order to do this, please select the volume field tab at the top of the window here, and then click the edit button next to the color map entry. This brings up the color map dialog, which consists of three sections. The first section shows the raw data histogram, which shows you the distribution of the image data values, and also allows you to set the minimum and maximum range of the visualization, which by default is set to minimum at first percentile and maximum at 99th percentile, but can also be changed to manual values, to the absolute minimum, maximum, or to an extended range. But we'll keep this at percentile for now. In the middle, you can see the transparency setting, which maps data values to a certain transparency value. Because we have disabled transparency here right now, this has no effect and is grayed out and cannot be interacted with. At the bottom, we can see the mapping of the data values to colors, which is reflected in the color scale that you can see next to the image as well. So the first thing I'd like to do is to change the color map. For this purpose, we click on the Lord color preset down here on the lower left and select the first color map, a simple black to white color map. And we can see that Geodict has already applied this color map in the background and updated the view. Because this is going to slow us down in the next step that we're going to perform, we're going to disable this apply immediately feature by unchecking this box. This means that any change that we make here is not directly reflected in the rendering, but once we click apply, it will be updated. Now, what I would like to do is I would like to isolate these material faces from each other. We can see that there is a dark pore space and there is a dark grayish material and there's a brighter gray material consisting of large grains and there's a very bright material which has geometric grains with sharp corners. And what we would like to isolate is this latter two material faces. So the geometric grains over here and the large bright gray grains over here. For this purpose, I would like to define a custom transparency transfer function. For this, I have to enable transparency first. And now you can see that this widget becomes active. And now we can see that this is a piecewise linear function, which has control points that can be dragged. By default, you only have two control points at the very extremes of the data range, but you can add any amount of points that you like. I would like you to add 6 points by clicking in the free space here, right click, add point, again, in the free space, right click, add point, again, and again. And now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 points. And I will move them like this. And now I'll click the apply button. And now if we move the dialog out of the way, we can see that these material faces are already well isolated, especially the one with the geometric grains. Now, in order to improve this visualization, we're going to add the same number of sample points in the color diagram down here and change the individual colors at the same positions as well. So again, we click right-click, add point, again, in the free space, you can always add a point like this. And now we move the X position of those points to coincide with the X positions up here, roughly. And now we change the color values by right-clicking on these points. Change color of the second point, change it to black. So this is going to be a constant portion. It's going to be all black. And we do the same over here. We set the second to last point to white, change color, white. And now for these inner points, we're going to choose a medium gray value. So again, right click on the point, change color, use 127, 127, 127. It's already at this value here. Let's check the other one. We also put 127, 127, 127 here. Sorry. And now we can click apply again. And we can see that the visualization has improved. And we can see that the material face with the larger grains is better visible than before. Now, next I would like to show you how you can save these settings. Once you have found a good visualization, you can click on the lower left button here, Save Current Settings to File, click it, and then you can give a file name, for example, My Color Map GPS. I already had one here, so I'll just override it. And now these settings are saved. And likewise, you can also load these settings again by clicking the second icon, Load Settings from File, select My Color Map GPS, and it will restore the same settings that you have saved. The other three icons down here correspond to loading the built-in default settings, loading the startup settings, that is, whatever settings are active as saved for your current Geodict installation, and save current settings as startup settings. So if you click this button and then quit Geodict, start it again, it'll come up with the same settings basically. Now let's close the dialog. And one more thing, that's a matter of personal taste or maybe corporate identity, and can also help improve the visualization, is the ability to change the background color. For this purpose, you can click this button up here next to the 3D icon, Color and Visibility Settings. And then you can see that that you can define a color palette here, and down here you can see that you can define a custom background color. Click on white here. Click on the three dots, and we will choose a dark gray as the backdrop for this. So we will put 66, 66, and 66 for the RGB channels respectively. And click close. And this gives you a nice visualization of the distribution of the different grain geometries in your data cube. And now, as I mentioned, the settings that you can save with a button in the dialog with this button, they only correspond to the entries in this dialog. But since we have changed the background color, which is here, we might also want to be able to save that. And there is a way to save the whole entire visualization settings by opening this tab on the right hand side using the double arrow here on the very right of the window. And here you can see the so-called visualization tree, which contains all the settings pertaining to visualization in Geodict. And you again get the same set of five icons. But if you save the settings file here, then it will include all the visualization settings. So that includes camera perspective, background color, the color map itself, and everything else, lighting, and all other settings. So if you want to reproduce an image, basically maybe with a different data set, reproduce an image from the same perspective with the same settings, this is what you can use. So you click this button and, for example, you give a file name My View Status, and then it's saved, which allows us to experiment a bit with some nicer colors. So again, we go to Color Map Edit up here. And first thing we want to do again, if it's activate, deactivate, apply immediately, because we want to set up some colors and then see the changes all at once. So for the top two points here in color, for the white grains, for the grains with the sharp corners, we will select a strong orange color. So right click these two points, change color, select this orange maybe, the other one as well. And then for the third point, which is this one, let's choose a somewhat medium bright blue. And a purple for this point, which should give us a nice color scheme for this data set. So now we can click apply and click close. And now we can see clearly how the two material phases that we're interested in, the geometric grains and the large bright gray grains, are nicely separated. And you can see where they are located in the structure. Now let's again save these visualization settings by opening the visualization tree if it's not open, then clicking Save Current View Status to File, and let's call it Nice Colors, maybe. Now, this was the part about the basic volume field visualization, and we will conclude this by saving a nice image before going to the voxel structure visualization. So, position the camera as you'd like to get a nice perspective on the structure. Again, this works by clicking each of the mouse buttons and moving the mouse at the same time. And then click File, Save Image As, in order to save the image. Here you have several options. First and foremost is the resolution. If we keep this at current resolution, it will use the viewport resolution as is. If you select custom resolution, keep aspect ratio, it will allow you to specify a new image width, and the height will be calculated to match the aspect ratio of the viewport, or you can also define a totally custom resolution. There's also the option of selecting some presets, which is some predefined standard resolutions or standard video resolutions that you can select. We'll just keep this at current resolution for now. Next up is the option to crop all empty space. What this means is that after the image is captured, it will crop all the background space around the image. So basically it will adjust the top, bottom, left and right borders of the image and remove all these gray background pixels here. Because we have a material lancet and these XYZ axes here, it will in this case only crop up to the corners of this material lancet. If we were to disable these lancets then and just keep the cube here, then it would crop the image up to the cube. And there's also the option to save the image with a transparent background, which is useful if you embed it in PowerPoint slides, for example. We'll just keep crop all empty space and deselect save with transparent background now. And click OK. And now it asks us to save the image. Let's just call it Nice Colors, maybe. Now it will save the image. And we can go to the project folder, and here we will find the image and can open it. For comparison, if I go to if I go back to the menu and save the image again, but select Save with Transparent Background, save it again, call it Nice Colors Transparent maybe. Then we go back to the project folder and we see that the image was saved with a transparent background, which is, as I said, better for embedding in PowerPoint slides, for example. Now that I've demonstrated how to visualize gray value image fields, I will show you how to visualize segmented microstructures. The difference is that in a gray value field you have a continuous value domain, while in a segmented microstructures you only have a small set of discrete materials, with each voxel being assigned one of these materials. Let's get started by getting rid of this data field by clicking File, Discard Structure and Fields, and now click File, Open Structure, and go to the part 1 subfolder of your project folder and load the file called segmented grain example. And now, the first thing I would like to do is to change the colors of this visualization. You can see that each of the material phases has been segmented, and the small grains have been assigned ID 1, the medium-sized grains have been assigned ID 2, and the sharp geometric grains here have been assigned material ID 5. The pore space has material ID 0. So in order to change these colors, we go again to the color and visibility settings dialog, which is up here next to the 3D button. We open it, and the first thing I would like to do is change the background color back to white. So we go down here to background color, click it, select white. And next, what I would like to do is to change the small grains to a white color as well by clicking the color chooser for ID 1 and selecting white. The medium sized grains, which are currently green, I would like to make gray. So click on the ID 2 assignment and make them a dark gray, like this maybe. And last but not least, I want to highlight these geometric sharp grains here by assigning them a red color. So go to ID 5 here, the color mapping for ID 5, and select red for that material phase. Now, one thing I would like to note is that for each of the colors, you can actually make them invisible, which is the default for pore space. So you can see here, ID 0 air has been assigned a color white, but it's also invisible. So that means the color white is never seen anywhere here because the pore space voxels are just transparent. And you can do that with all the other material phases. So for example, we can click make red invisible. Then you can see that you can see into the structure here, or we can make the ID2 invisible too. And you see that you can look into the material there. So, but we'll keep it as it is. So just the pore space is invisible, and we close the dialog. Now you'll notice that the material phase of interest, the red material over here, is in the shadows right now. We can change this by moving the light source. For this purpose, we click the light bulb icon up here in the toolbar. And now the function of the mouse changes from moving the camera to moving this light source. If you left click and drag, you can see how you can move the light source. I would like you to illuminate the face of the cube, which contains the red material over here. Now we go back to the normal control mode by clicking the mouse icon over here next to the light bulb, clicking once to get rid of the light source visualization. And now we will enable some advanced rendering modes, which improve the depth perception even more. For this purpose, we go to the camera tab up here. Then we select Show Outlines, Show Halo, and Global Lighting. And this will improve the rendering even a bit more. And now what we can also do is instead of rendering the voxels as the cubes that they are, we can smooth the representation to get an even nicer image. For this purpose, we go to the Structure tab up here. And instead of Box Renderer, we choose the Smooth Renderer up here. This will take a few seconds, and it depends on the amount of different materials that you have in your structure, how long it takes and how much memory it takes. But it usually gives you a much nicer image. We also have a GPU-based renderer, which you can activate by selecting GPU renderer up here. But this one is usually limited in the size of structures that you can visualize because it constructs a triangle mesh which has to fit into your GPU memory to work. But it is usually much faster to translate or rotate the structure with this renderer. But for our image here, we were going to be using the smooth renderer. So switch back to that. And now I will show you how to remove all the extraneous info that you might not need if you only want an image of your structure. For this purpose, you go to the View menu, go to Legends Overlays, and deactivate all these options over here. And now you see that you only have the structure in isolation, basically. So now that we have a nice illustration of our structure, we go again to the File menu, go to Save Image As, and we will try some other settings. For example, we can go to the Preset, select Full HD 1080p. We keep crop all empty space, which in this case, as I mentioned earlier, would crop right down to the data cube because we don't have any legend around the cube. And we also select Embed after cropping, which will add a small border to the image. And we will choose a border of, say, 5% in each direction by selecting percent up here and putting 5 everywhere. And we will save it with a transparent background. And let's call it smooth.png. Now we go to the project folder and open the image. And as we can see, the image was properly saved. This concludes part one of the visualization workshop. We have shown how to visualize volume fields, or rather gray value fields, and segmented microstructures.